name the god's thought in Greek mythology, the god of wisdom, right? He was the father of alchemy. Now, if you are not familiar with what alchemy is, it became, when they sort of did the start of the chemistry to change from an ordinary metal into gold. But the origins of the alchemy was not that. The origin was to change from a basic instinctual being to a manifestation of the divine within. So it's a spiritual journey that the alchemy is actually targeting, not the metals and everything else that came after that. So there's seven principles. The first one is the principle of mentalism. What the principle says is everything is mental. Everything that you see around you, it's a projection of your mental images. You create images and you see them moving around you. Now Kelly says the same thing. So he says man looks at the world through transparent patterns or templates that he creates. He views the world through his own creative constructs. People's thoughts really exist. So a very direct connection and the same type of teachings as the Hermetic principle of mentalism. The next one is the principle of correspondence. So what this principle says is that we live in an environment where there are more than one realm. It's not just the physical realm, that's the one that we can see through our senses. But there is also a mental realm, and there's also a spiritual realm. The mental realm we're very used to as academics. We pretty much live in our heads most of the time, but we also live into the physical. We don't have too much information as to how to reach the spiritual universe. The only thing that we have right now is the religious tenets that exist out there. But that's, again, a discussion to be made at a different time if the spiritual, the planes themselves, they're constantly moving together. They overlap constantly. But when are you in one versus when are you in the other? It's still a matter of debate at this point. Now, the same principle will say, and I'm sure you have heard that, as above, so below. What it's is within, so without. Same idea, what you see is what you actually projected. What's happening at the micro level, it's reflected at the micro level, and vice versa. Kelly admits the same thing, that there are more realms. So he talks about mental and the physical facts, the realms, the psychological constructions, and the natural science group of construction systems. And he also admits those realms actually overlap. So again, another alignment that we see with these ancient principles. The principle of cause and effect. There's a cause for the effect, there's an effect for the cause. And we'll get back to this with Kelly to see how he looks at that. And the principle of gender. Now, in this particular theory, the mind itself has two parts. You have the objective mind, you have the subjective mind, which is very much aligned with Freud, Carl Jung, the same idea, just different names, just different words that they would be using. So the objective mind is what you would be using in a day-to-day life events, right? That's how you're manifesting, that's how you're working. The feminine is that intuitive, that subconscious that you don't actually have direct access to it. You have to infuse it somehow. The principle of vibration, the science right now is actually supporting that, endorses the fact that everything is a vibration. So everything that you see right now, so if you look at my shirt, the color, some of you might see it blue, some of you might see it green. So what actually happens, this does not actually exist. And this is again endorsed by the science. It's just an energetic wave that goes to your retina. The back of the brain is actually translated or interpreted by your brain. And based on your prior experiences, you will interpret that as a certain type of color. Same thing happens when you hear. There is nothing out there, you're just vibrations that go to your hearing system, your brain interprets it, and you come up with whatever interpretation you have. Which obviously is based on a prior experience, it's based on who you as a storybook are and how you perceive the reality around you. So this, the principle of vibration, everything vibrates, nothing is at rest, everything is in continuous motion, right? All the emotions, all the mental states are accompanied by vibrations. The same thing we have from Kelly, we have the modulation for the person construction system is continuously in a state of flux. Universe is real, continuously changing with respect to itself. Now, one of the biggest things that we have with Kelly is the polarity, right? So we have the repertory grades, we have the two, you know, opposites, right? Well, there is a principle which is called the polarity principle in the Hermetic teachings. And what it says that everything has two poles, which obviously it's very much aligned with what Kelly is actually telling us and how we actually work with it. But there is more to this polarity than what, you know, it meets the eye at this particular point. The next one is the principle of rhythm. So the principle of rhythm says everything happens in a measured way. Now, if we look at our lives, and if you look back, you had times when everything went really well, then all of a sudden it's a big change happening, and then everything starts to move. So it's a wave-like move, right? Pendulum-like move that things come and go, and that's how the universe is actually moving. Now, going back to the rhythm principle, Kelly says the universe is an essential continuity operating between antecedent and subsequent events. So the same thing, there is a rhythm, there is a way of, there's a way in which things are moving, it's not randomly happening, right? Now, the other thing that I was mentioning was the cause and effect, and I really like this from Kelly. Says, ultimately, a man sets the measure of his own freedom and his own bondage by the level at which he chooses to establish his convictions. So you could become the cause of the effects that you're actually noticing or observing into your own life. Now, the third element that comes in now is mindfulness. Again, buzzword, big thing going on. All the schools have departments now. They're integrated, the mindfulness is integrated in the curriculum. My son is at McMaster University, and he's in medical radiation, and they actually do guided meditations in the class as part of their lectures. So it is something that is picking up, you know, quite fast. So lots of definitions, but I picked a couple of them that I felt they're more comprehensive. So one of them is the self-awareness of inner and outer shifts. So that's inner, within yourself, whatever is happening within yourself, whatever happens outside of yourself, being fully awake and alert in the present moment. Now, a more academic definition, Shinzen Yang has it, he calls it the threefold attentional skill, which includes concentration, clarity, and equanimity. And what does each one of them mean? Concentration, we do know what it means, right? Because we know how to focus, that's pretty much what we're looking at. Clarity, you know where you're at, you're very clear how you feel in the moment, you're very clear how you feel right now. You have anxiety, or you might not have anxiety, you're at peace, you're thinking about things, you're very clear where you're at and what you're doing. And the equanimity, this is a calm state. Now, equanimity, it's a term that it's been sort of debated a lot. And one of the things that the mindfulness literature sort of explains that it's a detached state. But detached state has been misinterpreted as being totally passive, but uninterested, indifferent. That's not what it is. So instead of me trying to explain it to you, why don't we try it experiential and see how it feels to yourself? So what I'd like you to do, you can keep your eyes open, you don't need to close your eyes, but it's entirely up to you. Just for a couple of seconds, observe what's happening in your head and in your body. If you're thinking, observe that you're thinking and just say, I'm thinking. Doesn't matter what you're thinking, I'm thinking. Then say to yourself, what's next? but a couple of nanoseconds, more thoughts will come. Observe, I'm thinking, what's next? And observe what's happening in your head when you say, what's next? Catch yourself thinking, I'm thinking, what's next? Now, I'm going to stop you because this is something that you can do on a regular basis, even as you walk and even as you think. But what you should have noticed is a moment of silence. When you said, what's next, your brain automatically moved into a state of expectancy. I'm watching. You're an observer now. You're very clear, you're concentrating, you're very clear, but also you're very calm. It's a lot of harmony. There is no attachment to any emotions. There's no attachment to any outcome. You just are in that moment. That's the state of equanimity. You might hear it as the space between thoughts. It's very small. It's a very small window. But the purpose of the meditation is to increase that window. So the more you become an observer of what's happening in your mind and in your body, the more that space becomes larger and larger, to a point that you can actually live in that space. So when you read about all these the monks that they have right now, there's a whole army of them, and how they're managing the mind, and they're talking about this continuous state of equanimity, and the only reason that they're using their mind is just for day-to-day activity. It's they manage to stay in this space between the thoughts. So I'm hoping you got a little taste of when you're just there between thoughts. Nothing is happening. You're not expecting anything, you just are. It's a pure state of being. And that is innate. That is something that we have naturally. We just don't have the tools right now to be awakened and be able to live with it. So this is the idea of a detached, neutral observer status. Now, the oldest meditation in the world, which says that the Buddha actually used it, was mudita, which is exactly what we have done now. You're just aware of what's happening in your head. You say, I'm thinking, I'm feeling, I'm seeing. Some people actually have visual images in their heads as well. Just noting it, just observing what happens, you become the observer of your mental state. And the science also has endorsed the fact that even at the molecular level, the minute you observe it, the behavior changes. So obviously the mind behavior will change. Now, the idea of there are some schools of thought that are saying you have to stop your thinking. Really, you cannot do that. Just as you cannot stop your kidneys from working, you cannot stop your heart from beating, you cannot stop your thinking. What you can stop is the compulsive thinking and staying more within the space between your thoughts. This is the thoughts where intuition arises, because there is no attachment. There is no thinking, there is no emotional charge. It's just you waiting for things to happen, things to arise. The universe is a vibrating flow of impermanence, perceived through mental images, internal talk, and emotional feelings. That is the definition in mindfulness of what the universe is, which we can see it's very, very much so aligned with the mentalism and the vibration principle. So here's what mental transmutation is in the ancient teaching of Hermetic. So they say that you have the will, you have the mental power. The only thing that you have to do is to change the vibration. So if I am depressed, I'm at very, very low vibration. I'm barely moving, I'm just sitting there, right? So I need to change that vibration, and I do that by using the will or mental power, and intentionally put my attention on a different state, on a different mental state, more desirable. Please note, it does not say move to the opposite pole, move from, you know, I'm being depressed to I'm being ecstatic, by no means. It says a more desirable pole, which means I might choose to move from depressed into an anger, because anger now means action, means I'm moving from a state of doing nothing into a state that I want to do something about. And progressively, I will move to the next state, which might be maybe just frustration, and progressively move to the next state. So the mental transmutation goes on the idea that you're using the will to direct the attention to change the vibration, but you're doing that in a progressive way. Now, Kelly says, man can enslave a state by his own ideas and then win his freedom again by reconstructing his life. If prior constructs are not reviewed, the alternatives available are only unhappiness or misery. The individual is held hostage to circumstance. The same thing he says also, when you're doing the reconstruction process, it says to do it in a progressive manner, not jumping ship here, progressively. So progressive evolution by assessing desirability for temporary retention, revision, or replacement. So at the end of the day, what we're dealing with, it's a rational process. The rational process is done in the now, which is what mindfulness will tell you. You live in the now. You don't live in the past. You don't live in the future. You recreate the past by constantly reminding yourself about it. You create some of the future by anticipating those particular events. But the reality is, any change that you can make, it's in the now, right now. You're looking at all these patterns and you're trying to revise them. So men, the scientist, which is the theme in Kelly's, applies very much so with both the Hermetics teachings as well as the mindfulness. So we have the ability, the cognitive ability, the rational ability to actually change at will mental states by changing the vibration and by progressively working towards a more desirable state. Now, to actually be able to get there, you need to reach that state of equanimity. So that's the state. So we really don't want to live on one side or the other side, right? The Buddhists will say, find the middle way, right? You don't really want to be in the extreme. You want to be somewhere in the middle where it's balanced, where it's calm, where it's harmony. And that's where the equanimity is all about. Finding that space, finding that state that will allow you to stay there and make, obviously, the best decision at the time. Now, some of more advanced mindful literature talks about an intellectual understanding. So even mindfulness, even Buddhists say you need to intellectually, to rationalize whatever you're going through prior to actually moving in that intuitive understanding, which is the basis of the true awakening. Now, in terms of semantics, right now we're using mindfulness and awareness interchangeably, but they're not the same. And the mindfulness literature is very clear that it's not the same. So awakening is equated to awareness. So you're awake, you're in a constant state of equanimity. You're constantly knowing what's happening around you, within yourself. You're not attached to any emotional charges out there. You just are within yourself, that's all. So that's what they will define as awareness. And they also consider that mindfulness as a process precedes the actual awareness, the state of awakening. So it's a twofold process that you have to do. One is the cause, being mindful and rationally understanding what's happening, and will, you know, being having the intention to change those mental states will actually allow you to get to a point to create or recreate yourself, if you wish, as to who you would like to be, not who you have been conditioned to be by your existing environment. So a rationally directed approach. Now, going back to the initial questions that we had in terms of is equanimity a product of meditation, or it's something of a dispositional nature? we think that it has to do with both, that you need meditation as the process, the proceeding to create a habit, because at the end of the day, you just create the habit to stay at a certain level within yourself. And once you create that habit, then you are able to stay there and, you know, evolve from that point on. So it's a dual process, not one shot yet. So that's pretty much what I'm trying to, you know, give you some food for thought, a little bit of reflection of understanding how there is a lot of ancient knowledge that we're going back to. And I'm hoping that the psychology, right now we have no tools to cultivate this. I'm hoping that we have a lot of tools from a psychiatric perspective to deal with the symptoms, with the effect, but we need to address the cause. So if we learn how to cultivate those states at an early age, then, you know, we will be able to actually sustain, this will become quite a sustainable mental state, which obviously will become universal. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed it.